You're watching a series called Light in the Darkness, a journey through the Gospel of John from the Axis Church in downtown Nashville. For more information and resources, visit theaxischurch.org.
Welcome and good morning. I'm Jeremy, one of the pastors here at the Axis Church, and I'm glad that you are with us. This is our fifth Sunday as we're working our way through the Gospel of John, a series entitled that we've entitled Light in the Darkness. So if you haven't already done so, turn to the Gospel of St. John, chapter 1 and verse 29. For those who don't have copies of the John Journal, it's the copy of the Gospel of John, which journal pages, you can raise your hand and we'll get them to you. They're free for you. If you want some, we'll get you some. Just hold it up and we'll get it to you. Thanks, guys. This eyewitness account, this Gospel of John, is written by the closest friend that Jesus Christ had. This gospel account, the entire Bible, the Holy Bible, has been carefully passed down throughout history to make its way to you, even this morning. And its intended destination is not merely your ears for hearing, but for your heart, for believing. And my prayer for you this week, in light of the passage that's before us today, is that you would see, that you would truly see the real Jesus, and go all in with him like never before, trusting him with your eternity, but also trusting him with your today. And I've been praying that you would personally experience the Holy Spirit of God working in your life, convicting the Christian of sin, which produces humility, holiness, and obedience, but also that you would experience the Holy Spirit working in the hearts of those who aren't Christians yet, convicting you of your need for rebirth, to be made alive to God and all the things of God. Even now as we open this wonderful book of God, Father, move in our hearts, I pray. Move in our hearts in these ways. Find us all open, like our Bibles, open to you and all that you would like to do within us. Humble us, convict us, help us to respond to you so that we might experience life and fun to the fullest. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. All right, let's get to work. This passage is given to us a little bit backwards. Verses 29 to 34 is where we're going to be hanging out this morning. but as far as its storyline and its narrative flow, it's a little choppy. It's kind of broken up. Like a newspaper journalist, John the author gives us the headline first. He doesn't bury the lead of his story. He tells us of this story and this moment, beginning with, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And it's sort of a startling beginning to this moment. I'm going to, instead of going 29 through 34, I'm going to go through it in this order. If you want to jot down these numbers real quick, here's the order we're going to go through them to help it chronologically fit a better storyline. 31 is where we're going to start, and then we're going to jump to 33, back to 32, 34, 30, and then end with the first one, 29, okay? So let's read it in that way. Okay, so verse 31. Well, before that, just kind of set precedent and context. They're asking John the Baptist, why are you baptizing? You're out here in the wilderness baptizing. Why are you baptizing? And who are you? He's like, I'm just a voice calling out to anybody and everybody, announcing the arrival of the promised Messiah, the anointed one. I'm saying, prepare the way for Christ, the anointed one, the one promised by God. I myself, verse 31, I myself did not know him. I didn't understand him and perceive him as Messiah. But for this purpose, I'm answering your question that they ask in verse 25. For this purpose, I came baptizing with water that he, Christ, might be revealed to Israel, might be made visible and clear, identifiable. Verse 33, I myself did not know him in this way, but he who sent me, God, sent me to baptize with water, he said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Verse 32, and John bore witness, he testified to this, that I saw the Spirit come down, descend from heaven like a dove, and it stayed with him. It remained on him. Verse 34, and I have seen and I've borne witness that this is the Son of God. Verse 30, this is he of whom I said earlier, after me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me. And then verse 29, when he saw Jesus coming toward him, after he identified himself with that identifying factor of something descending like the dove, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, who picks up the sin, who carries away the sin, who removes the sin. Now, to the original audience, the first hearers of this dramatic, bolsterous declaration, hearing a lamb would have immediately recalled them thinking of the sacrificial system, the sacrificial lamb. The offering up of the temple animal sacrifices was very familiar to the Jews. It'd be hard to imagine them hearing the Lamb of God and not think of animal sacrifices. But what would have been new and really different and perhaps even disturbing to the first audience would be John the Baptist conveying the image of a sacrificial lamb onto a person. I seriously doubt the original audience would have thought Isaiah 53, John the Baptist would. I doubt the original audience would. Here's a little bit of Isaiah 53. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of the dry ground. He, speaking of Jesus, hundreds of years before he was born, describing him, he had no form or majesty that we should look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our sins and transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, which is what a sacrificial lamb experiences. Upon him was a chastisement that brought us peace. And it's by his wounds that we are healed. And all of us are like sheep. We've gone astray. We've turned every one of us to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him like a lamb the iniquity of us all. And he was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth like a lamb that is led to the slaughter. Through the life and teaching of Jesus, by the time he was pinned by nails upon the Roman cross, there will be no doubt that his mission was to be the slaughtered Lamb of God, who would provide perfect and innocent blood that would atone and cover the sins and sinners in order to forgive them and reconcile them back into good standing forever with God. Jesus understood that he was to vicariously suffer, to stand in the place of some, to be placed in the place of another. He was to suffer in this way and be killed as the sacrificial Lamb of God to save sinners. It's why he was born. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. In our reading plan yesterday, we read Numbers 28, very similar to what's found in Exodus 29. Jesus understood the significance and fulfillment of these sorts of passages like this, speaking of the sacrificial system. This is just a little taste of what it meant to have a lamb sacrificed for you before the cross had happened. Now, this is what you shall offer on the altar: two lambs, a year old, day by day, regularly. One lamb you'll offer in the morning, the other lamb you offer at twilight, every single day of your life. With the first lamb, a tenth measure of fine flour mingled with a fourth of a hin of beaten oil and a fourth of a hin of wine for a drink offering. The other lamb you will offer at twilight and shall offer it with grain offering and its drink offering as in the morning for a pleasing aroma, a food offering to the Lord. And it shall be a regular burnt offering throughout your generations at the entrance of the tent of meeting before the Lord. There I will meet with you, God said, and I will speak with you there. There I will meet with the people of Israel, and it shall be sanctified by my glory. I will consecrate, I will set apart the tent of meeting and the altar. Aaron, the high priest, also and his sons, I will consecrate to serve me as priests. I will dwell among the people of Israel and will be their God, and they shall know that I am the Lord their God who brought them out of the land of Egypt that I might dwell among them. I am the Lord their God. You see, it's through these daily sacrifices, among many other sacrifices, that mankind could relate properly with God, even for a moment, until you sinned. And then you had to go through all this again. But through Jesus Christ being sent as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, we no longer have to sacrifice animals daily, weekly, monthly, annually, day by day, regularly. We don't have to make sacrifices every time we sin throughout a given day. Rather, we plead the mercy of God and we embrace the forgiveness of God that comes to us through the grace of God that is based not on the blood of an animal, but based upon the blood of the Lamb of God who was slain as us, for us, in our place. Hebrews chapter 9 and 10 tells us about this. Hebrews 9, starting in verse 26. But as it is, he, Jesus, has appeared as a sacrifice once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for man once to die, and after that comes the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, which is what a lamb does in the sacrificial system, he bears the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin. He did that 2,000 years ago. But he's coming a second time to save those who eagerly await for him. Therefore, eagerly await for him. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1. For since the law has but a shadow of good things to come, instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, think about it. Would they not have ceased to be offered these sacrifices since the worshipers, having been cleansed once, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. You see that? It's impossible for the sacrificial animals to take away sin. They provide a temporary covering, but they can't take away the sin. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 11, every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices. You get the redundancy here, right? Every high priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, speaking of himself, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet through the resurrection. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified, set apart for God. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord, I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. He then adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. For where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. There is a reminder, going back to chapter 10, verse 4 of Hebrews, in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. But through Christ, there is a reminder of forgiveness every moment, instead of remembering our sins every year. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Continuing in Isaiah 53, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth, like a lamb that's led to the slaughter, like sheep that's before its shears is silent. So he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the sin and transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked and with the rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and although there was no deceit in his mouth, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him as a sacrificial lamb. he has put him to grief. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous. And he will bear their iniquities, the work of a sacrificial lamb. Because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with sinners, the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, which is what a sacrificial lamb does, and makes intercession for the sinners and transgressors. Behold the Lamb of God who does what sacrificial animals can't do. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away and doesn't just provide a temporary covering, takes away the sin of the world. It's the Lamb. It's not a lamb. It's not another lamb. It is the Lamb of God. That prepositional phrase, of God, it belongs to him. It is the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God who was sent into the world by God, provided by God for the sins of the world, for the sinners of the world. This Lamb of God showed up to take away the sin of the world. This taking away is present tense with future force. He continues to take away the sin of the world. His sacrifice 2,000 years ago is still sufficient to cover your sins. And clumsy Christian, along with me, all your sins were future sins 2,000 years ago when they were covered. There's grace. Thank God there's grace. John the Baptist wanted everybody to grasp that Jesus was the Lamb who would be the perfect, once and for all, sacrifice and substitute given to atone for the sin of not just Israel, but for every tongue, tribe, people, and nation who would by faith believe Jesus as Messiah. And that goes for you too today. If you would simply stop and look to Jesus by faith and believe him, his blood covers you and you are forgiven and made right with God. This message of salvation for the world would have been foreign to the Jew. They were looking for a Messiah for their people, to make the Jewish nation a people, a protected people, a superior people, and all non-Jews would serve them. But here comes John the Baptist talking about a Lamb of God who's going to take away the sin of even non-Jews. That was different. In verse 30, John repeats what he said back in verse 15. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me. He's superior because he was before me. This repetition humbly reemphasizes the superiority of Jesus over John the Baptist, which is what John wanted everyone to understand. He's just a voice pointing to the Word made flesh. He wanted everyone to know that Jesus was bigger and better than anyone ever. And he wanted them to know that this man, Jesus, had come to save them back to the Father once and for all, that he is preeminent. It's how the book of John starts. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word, speaking of Jesus, was with God. And Jesus was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Jesus, and without Jesus was not anything made that was made. Preeminent. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted Jesus and bestowed on Jesus the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. He's preeminent. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 15, he's the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Jesus, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through Jesus. All things were created for Jesus. And he is before all things. And in Christ Jesus, all things hold together. Jesus is the head of the body of the church. Jesus is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. In Hebrews chapter 1, starting out hot in verse 1, long ago and at many times God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days he's spoken to us by his son Jesus, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. And he upholds the universe that you're living in right now by the word of his power. Jesus Christ is preeminent. In Revelation chapter 4 and verse 9, whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. And they cast down their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory, to receive honor, to receive power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist, and by your will they were created." Preeminent. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is preeminent. Do not reduce the Christ. He is preeminent. This is John's message. And in verse 31, John the Baptist said, "I myself did not know him, but for this purpose I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed." So when John says he didn't know Jesus, he's speaking, he didn't know him as the anointed one, the promised one, the Messiah. Of course, John knew Jesus. They were cousins. They were related to one another. But John didn't realize that Jesus was the Lamb. He didn't realize that he was the Messiah until the special divine revelation of the Spirit, which was like a dove. And we learn about that in verses 32 and 33. What John the Baptist is essentially saying, really all throughout chapter 1, is the reason I came baptizing with water was to get to the right place at the right time, to see a sign that God told me I would see. And he told me whenever I saw it to constantly and always point people to the Messiah who's here. God just told me to go out into the wilderness and begin preaching that he's here. He told me to preach that all must repent to make ready for him. He basically told me just baptize and you keep baptizing and you keep preaching until you see something special happen to a certain man. And you'll know it when you see it. You'll know him when you see him. He's in effect answering what they ask in verse 25. Why are you baptizing? I'm baptizing until I see something special happen. That's why I'm baptizing. What was that sign? Look in verse 33. "I myself did not know him in this way, but God the Father who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.'" This is the one you're looking for. "And John bore witness. I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him." Now, this wasn't literally a dove. This is a simile. It's a figure of speech involving the comparison of a thing with another thing of a different kind, often using the words like or as. My English teachers would be so proud of this moment. John was trying to describe what it was that he saw. It was a manifestation that he'd never experienced before. It was something that he saw that he'd never seen before, nothing like it. And this was the moment he'd been waiting for all his life. And this really models what we see in Genesis 1, verse 2, as the Spirit hovering over the waters. The Spirit, this dove-like thing, hovering over Jesus, identifying him as the Christ. Now, it's theologically important to note that this wasn't Jesus receiving the Spirit. This is not Jesus becoming Spirit-filled or more Spirit-filled, okay? This is not when Jesus became divine. He wasn't just a dude, and then this happened, and he became God. He was always divine. He was always God. He was never empty of the Spirit, void of the Spirit to any degree. He never lacked the Spirit of God. All right, he was never 99.9% the Spirit. He was 100% God, 100% man. He's always been divine. He will always be divine. After all, it's his Spirit that we refer to when we say the Holy Spirit. Remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him was not made anything that was made. As a baby, Jesus was perfect. As a toddler, Jesus was perfect. As a child, Jesus was perfect. As a teenager, Jesus was perfect. If not, how could he be the perfect, sinless, spotless Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world? As a young man, Jesus was perfect. As a grown man, Jesus was perfect. Jesus is perfect in his life. He was perfect throughout his suffering. He was perfect throughout his death. He was perfect in his resurrection. He was perfect in his ascension. He is perfect when he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He is perfect right now as he rules and reigns over all creation. He'll be perfect when he returns, and he'll be perfect when he makes all things right, perfect, and new again in the new heavens and the new earth. This sign was not to reveal something to Jesus that he didn't already know about himself. He wasn't just out there and this thing happens over top. He's like, oh, I must be the Messiah. He knew who he was. This event, this phenomenon of the Spirit revealing the Messiah, who it was for John. That's why God told him, go baptize until you see this thing happen. This thing's happened. That's the Messiah. Jesus knew himself. In fact, you remember when he was a little boy, his parents lost him. It's like, you're to steward the Son of God. They're like, where's the Son of God? We literally lost the Messiah. Creation is in trouble, even more than ever, right? And in Luke chapter 2, 48, when they found him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been searching you in great distress. And he said to them, as a little boy, why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house, the temple of God? That's his dad's house. He knew who he was. He knew who he belonged to. John witnessed a glorious phenomenon of something like a dove resting on Jesus, identifying him as the Messiah. And this portion of John has been written down and handed down to us in order for us to have an eyewitness perspective of what happened when John the Baptist realized that Jesus was the Messiah. It's like his testimony, his statement regarding the first time he saw him. And it was at this point that John the Baptist knew this man Jesus was bringing about a new era of grace as the law was being fulfilled. And he was pumped about it. He was excited. Not only did this sign point out who the Messiah was, but it also enabled John to identify Jesus as the one who would baptize with the Holy Spirit, which happens after Christ ascends back into heaven after he beat death. You can read about it in Acts of the Holy Spirit, chapter 2. This Spirit baptism is vividly contrasted with John's water baptism. It's superior to it, which was John's point. He spoke about that in verse 26 when he essentially said, I baptize just with water, but there's one coming after me that's going to baptize with the Spirit of God. You see, John the Baptist and your elders today, we baptize with just water, but it allows you to identify with Jesus, telling others about your assurance and your faith in Christ as Lord and Savior, that you're a believer, that you're a follower of Jesus. But Jesus is the bearer and dispenser of a greater baptism, a baptism of the Spirit. And this is what John's water-only baptism was pointing towards. We all must experience this greater baptism of the Spirit, and not just with water. You see, this greater baptism takes place as the Holy Spirit gives you eyes to see Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. But not just this. Seeing Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, but the Lamb of God who takes away your sin. When you, by faith, behold Jesus and you trust him to be the Savior of your eternal soul, as well as the Lord of your temporal life, the Holy Spirit is already there. He's present and he promises to never leave you. This is being born again. This is being made alive. This is an awakening to God, your perfect and good and gracious Heavenly Father. This is you experiencing this greater baptism. This is being baptized by the Holy Spirit with the Holy Spirit. And John preached of it, and it is what enabled him to say in our concluding verse for today, I have seen and I have borne witness. This is the Son of God. In the Greek here, this word seen translates the idea of a settled conviction. I have seen and I just know it to my core. This is the Son of God, the one in whom I place my faith. Is this how you see Jesus? Have you experienced this new and greater baptism? This experience of the Holy Spirit in your life, giving you eyes to see Jesus? I'm not asking if you know facts about Jesus. I'm not asking about historical data that you might know about Jesus, things he did, things he said. I'm not asking if you just have started to live a moral lifestyle like Christ. Have you experienced the renewal of life within, where you know God is in your life with you, where there's a renewal, there's a conviction where there wasn't one before, there's a peace where there wasn't there before. I remember hearing a story about my dad when he became a Christian. He was playing football at Appalachian State University. And he was on offense, and there was a defensive linebacker, Gary Cuccio, who's technically my grandfather in the faith. Pretty cool. Gary Cuccio drilled my dad, almost separated his sternum, almost put his eye out. This is back when football was a tad more violent than it is today. And Gary Cuccio met him up in the clinic because he felt terrible about this because he had just become a Christian. He was a notoriously like savage football player. Like razor blades in his arm pads and things like, he was cruel. But then he became a Christian. He's trying to undo his reputation and fix it straight as a Christian. So he felt deeply convicted, did not want my dad to feel a mixed message about his hit. He did not mean to hurt him. Well, after he left my dad there in the clinic, he stopped and turned around and said, "Hey, Bub, can I?" My nickname for my dad's Bubba. And so he's like, "Hey, Bub, can I ask you a question?" He's like, "Sure." He's like, "Are you a Christian?" That's how you do it, by the way. You don't have to be like suave about it. Just like, "Are you a Christian?" My dad was like, "Well, I guess." He's like, "Do you know Jesus?" I'm like, "Well, I guess so." He said, "Have you ever experienced the Holy Spirit of God in your life?" He's like, "I don't guess." He's like, "Can I tell you about Jesus?" And right there in that clinic, my dad became a Christian. He experienced not just data, not just knowledge, but he experienced what it is that we're talking about here. He experienced the Spirit of God who takes away the sin of the world. Let's see how John sees Jesus. I want to close with these two things. One, he sees Jesus as the Lamb of God in verse 29. He sees his mission of Jesus, the Messiah, as Jesus giving himself up as the unblemished, perfect, spotless, holy sacrifice, whose blood would be poured out in his sacrifice of himself to save and protect God's chosen people from the coming judgment of God upon their sin. He died in their place. But he also sees in verse 34 that he is the Son of God. But my question for you is, who do you say that Jesus is? My friend, your life will ultimately be defined by the answer to that question. Who do you say that Jesus Christ is? There is no greater question that you will ever answer in your lifetime. The repercussions and implications of the answer you give to this from your heart, not your head, and the honesty and sincerity of who you are and how you live. Who do you say that Jesus Christ is? Jesus asked his own disciples this in Mark chapter 8 about who others and who they believe Jesus to be. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they told him, "John the Baptist." Others say Elijah. Others, one of the prophets, which for those who've been hanging out with us in John, it's kind of the answers that many people have given about even John the Baptist, right? He answered them back, "But who do you say that I am? I know what others might think. I know what your grandma thinks. I know what your parents think. Perhaps I know what even some of your children think. I know what your boss thinks. I know what your pastor thinks. But who do you say that I am?" Peter said, "You are the Christ." Who do you say that he is? If you say that Jesus is God, that he is your Lord and Savior, how does your way of life, how does your actions line up with those words? In other words, does the way that you go about life say that Jesus is God over you? Does the way that you go about life say that Jesus is your Savior and Master and Lord and ruler and owner? Your boss, the one who tells you what to do, when to do it, if you need to do it. Like if you couldn't audibly say, "Jesus is my Lord and Savior," would your actions speak what you believe? Jesus asked a gripping question in Luke chapter 6 and verse 46. "Why do you call me Lord, Lord? Why do you say that I'm God? Why do you say that I'm Lord? And not do what I tell you to do?" Remember what he said in Matthew chapter 7 and 21. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And on that day, many," that's heartbreaking, And let's not think of others. Let's think of ourselves. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons in your name? Did we not do mighty works in your name? And I will declare to them, I never knew you. You knew stuff about me, but you didn't know me, nor did I know you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. In other words, you can be a spiritual person and not be a Christian. And there's a form of spirituality that exists that's totally void of the Holy Spirit being involved. What do you truly believe about Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Messiah? If you say and sincerely believe that Jesus is Savior, man, this is a wonderfully glorious statement to hold fast to, that he is your Savior. This speaks of your eternity. This speaks of your eternal future. This sees Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is in reference to the finished, completed work of Jesus Christ, where Jesus Christ alone has fought for you, for him to be your Savior. Jesus being your Savior, this is in regards to your justification. Just as if you've never sinned, just as if you've always obeyed, where God forensically acts on your behalf as you hope and trust and follow Jesus by faith, seeing Jesus as your rescuer and your redeemer. Jesus as your Savior is settled. It's permanent. It's sturdy. It's sure. It's unshakable. It's unchangeable. The Spirit of God comes upon you, within you, forever, and you can't mess it up. It's settled. Heaven is yours to enjoy. What a splendid blessing and sweet grace it is to know Jesus as Savior. What do you truly believe about Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Messiah? If you say and sincerely believe that Jesus is Lord, that too is a wonderfully gracious statement to hold fast to. Jesus being Lord, Savior is eternity, Lord is today. Jesus is my Lord over today. Now, in my opinion and my clumsy experience, it's easier to believe Jesus as Savior than it is to believe him as Lord. You see, Christ's obedience reinforces our hope in him as Savior. He holds it fast. Our obedience enforces our hope in him as Lord. It speaks to how, to what degree we actually hope in him. And this is in regards to our sanctification. Jesus being your Lord, this means that he calls the shots of your life. You stop living your way of life. You stop thinking about life the way you think about it, going about life the way you go about it, and you conform into who it is he's calling you to be by what he's given you in Scripture. You see, if Jesus is your Lord, he is your master. He is your boss. And there's often a frustrating fluidity with our sanctification. He worked for our justification, settled. We're working with him in our sanctification. We try and we fail. We confess, we repent, we try again. There's highs and there's lows in the Christian walk of sanctification. Not so with our justification. Remember, it's settled. But in our sanctification, it's the Holy Spirit of God working within you, with you. And since we're involved, there's a clumsiness about it, and that's the fluidity that I'm speaking of. Here in your day-to-day life, you are to live a life of humble submission to God, not a life of pride, seeking the satisfaction of your earthly fleshly desires. Your actions of following, not following Jesus as Lord has direct impact upon your daily life and the power wherewith you live it. Sanctification is speaking of what happens today, like in this life, right now, this side of heaven. This deals with the fruit of the Spirit and the fruit of the flesh. The fruit of the Spirit of God, he's actively working within you to produce this fruit. It reflects him. You have a Christ-like way about you, about your words, about your actions and your tone. There's a holiness about you. There's a gentleness, a godliness, a strength, a power. This is simply the natural fruit of someone who has been made a Christian. This lordship and submission to Christ means that we fight the drift with the Spirit's help and power and comfort and guidance. And here's the thing. You may trust Jesus as Savior when you die your death, But do you trust Jesus as Lord when you live your life? There's a difference. It's much easier to say that Jesus is Savior and Lord than it is to live that way. And I'm grateful that there's grace in our sanctification. There still must be much unction in our following of Jesus as our daily Lord. There must be grit in our godliness, Christian. There must be some teeth about our gears of holiness. It takes effort to sacrifice part of who you are, to deny yourself, to take up your cross and walk towards God in clumsy Christian obedience. But a happy Christian is one who by faith follows Jesus as Savior of their sin and Lord of their life. And an unhappy, often miserable, distracted, and proud Christian follows Jesus as Savior with my eternity, but not as Lord with my today. And unfortunately, there's no concept in the New Testament of a healthy Christian who sees him as Savior, but doesn't follow him as Lord, has no concept. So let's not invite that into our day. If we can't find it here, it shouldn't be here, and it shouldn't be here. What do you truly believe about Jesus, the Lamb of God? This morning as your pastor, I'm calling you to submit your life to Christ, to go all in with him, that you humble yourself like you've never humbled yourself before, that you go after God like you've never gone after him before, and that you ask God for mercy and forgiveness and receive grace, that you believe Christ to be Savior and follow him to be your Lord. I want to close, and I want you to think about these words out of Romans chapter 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, I'm appealing, I'm begging you, present your life, your bodies, as a living to God, sacrifice to yourself. You're dead to yourself, alive to God. I'm asking that you humble yourself to where you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Believe Jesus as Savior, and you're a Christian. Follow Jesus in more faithful and humble obedience, and you'll become a happier Christian with much more power and victory. Well, as we turn our eyes toward the Lord's table, the table of the crucified and risen Lord, I ask that you confess your sins now. Confess your clumsiness. Confess your need for power and grace of the Spirit to work within you. Ask him to humble you more. Ask him to help you follow him more closely. Ask him to help you follow him to the degree that the dust off his sandals gets on your shins. You begin looking like him, acting like him more and more. Not because you're trying so hard to, but because you're so close to him, you can't help but mimic. It's like what our little children do of us as parents. Mimic our Savior authentically from the heart. Humbly come to the table and ask for mercy and find it. There's mercy here for you today. Focus your attention and your affection on the work of Christ. We've got broken pieces of bread that are symbolic of the life that Christ lived as us. We've got juice or wine, the red liquid, symbolic of the blood that Christ shed so that we could be forgiven once and for all. This is not the blood of the goats that this is symbolic of. It's the blood of the Lamb of God who has taken away our sin. And so my clumsy Christian friends, stumble your way to the Lord's table today and find mercy and grace in your time of need. Let's pray together. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we proclaim the great mystery of the Christian faith, that Christ has come, he's lived, he's died, he's risen, he's ascended to heaven, and he'll come again. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be on this time of communion and response, and remain with us always through the end of the age. Amen. Christian, this is for you. We've got servers on either side of the stage and servers in the very back. Please come and receive mercy.